So, Professor Pallikarakis, you have the floor.
Thank you very much for this presentation, and I'm very happy to be here with you today and join all the other speakers in the celebration of Professor Victor Sotea for his 70th anniversary. I was lucky to have a collaboration with him in a European project, and I know that he is a great man and a fantastic personality that contributed a lot in the field of biomedical engineering, clinical engineering. After this very interesting presentation of Professor Mimura, I will address a completely different subject, and that is the role of clinical engineers in the hospitals. And in this role, Professor Victor Sotea played, in the recognition of this role, Professor Sotea played a big, has a big, let's say, contribution during the last 30 or more years. I spent a few hours to prepare a video recording of my speech, and although I'm not so happy with the result, you allow me to use this video and then answer to the questions. So I will move to the video now. I think we have some problems, but we will soon be back.
Hi, everybody. I'm happy to participate again this year in the fifth edition of this very successful series of international conferences on nanotechnologies and biomedical engineering. And I would like to thank the organizing committee, and particularly the professors Ion Higianu and my friend Victor Sotea for this invitation. I'm sad, from the other side, that this conference is not a face-to-face event due to COVID-19, but I hope that in the near future, the next edition will happen as in the past, on a face-to-face basis, and we will be happy to enjoy the event. I'm coming from Patras and the Biomedical Technology Unit that has been created in 1989, and the research topics and the field of biomedical engineering is preoccupied is X-ray medical image reconstruction and simulation, also biomedical instrumentation and measurements with focusing on biosensors, and the clinical engineering, medical technology management, including healthcare technology assessment and vigilance. Also, in 1991, we created the Institute of Biomedical Technology as a non-profit organization aiming to support the development of biomedical technology sector in Greece. The main product that we produce are concerning medical device management systems, and particularly now in the fifth edition of such systems is the Web Praxis. And also we provide services concerning nomenclature, inventory, studies on investment planning for hospitals and regional healthcare systems, acceptance testing, and so on. We have a very long collaboration with WHO, and this has been reinforced during the last 10 years with Adriana Velasquez taking the lead of the medical device sector. And we had also during the economic crisis in Greece during the last 5 years, a very closer collaboration with the Greek office of WHO on several studies on in vitro diagnostics and high value capital equipment in healthcare in Greece, and specification on some kind of medical device, and such as hip and knee replacement and other implants. And also we organize a workshop and some reports on health technology assessment implementation in Greece. You will all agree that healthcare today is technology driven and team based. The medical devices that are appearing in an accelerated pace during the last 20 years are the results of research of university labs, of institutes, of independent organizations, and from the activities of WHO. There are also regulatory bodies that they are looking to the legal framework, applying the legal framework for putting medical devices on the markets, and the competent authorities and the notified bodies, they are playing a crucial role in this procedure. From the other side, we have the medical device manufacturers and the decision makers of the healthcare systems, that they decide on the use of medical devices and devices. And finally, the devices are used in the hospitals and patients. Speaking about health technologies, we mean any intervention that may be used to promote health, to prevent, diagnose, or treat diseases, or for rehabilitation purposes. This includes pharmaceuticals, devices, procedures, and organizational systems used in healthcare. Medical devices are part of this health technology, with starting from very simple devices like masks that are used during the last period for COVID-19 very intensively, to syringes and catheters and so on, going to medical equipment that are more complicated devices and including in vitro diagnostics, implantable devices and active implantable devices, or high value capital medical equipment that it is the most cost, let's say, costly technology in use today. The device industry is a very active sector. Actually, it is estimated that it is beyond the 400 billion euros per year, with more than 500,000, probably 1 million medical technologies registered today. And in this sector, the European medical technology industry is very active one, with more than 25 medical technology companies in Europe, providing products of almost one third of the world production, and very active in research, as it is demonstrated by the more than 12,000 patents registered every year in Europe health technology. Actually, health technology is the first one in terms of patents deposited today, going almost double than the one of pharmaceuticals or biotechnology patents. Overall health technology life cycle starts with an initial idea and with R&D that goes on in its own circle with development, testing, evaluation, redesign, and specification of a prototype that then goes to preclinical testing. And then if everything is successful, we can speak about an innovation. And if this innovation is a new technology, then it has to go through clinical studies to prove that it is safe and efficient to be used in humans. And if everything is again successful, we have the submission of the dossier for regulatory approval to the appropriate authority. And if the technology follows the regulation standards, directives, and good manufacturing practice, and everything that it is demanded by the regulations, they get approval for this technology and be able to manufacture, to have a product that is put on the market and used in a clinical or environment or by the patient themselves. In cases that these devices are medical equipment, then that are used in the hospital environment, then clinical engineering come into the scene, and clinical engineering departments are responsible for the procurement, planning of medical equipment investment, procurement processes, management, vigilance, and so on. And finally, the technology, if it becomes obsolescence, has to be taken out of use. And this is also a decision where clinical engineers are playing a big role. Finally, in another cycle, when enough information and evidence is available, we have health technology assessment that leads to reimbursement of the most efficient and cost-effective technologies to be used by the healthcare systems in every country. There are three pillars that are addressing safety and effectiveness of medical devices. The first one concerns regulation, and it is mainly addressing issues of demands on placing a medical device on the market according to its safety, performance, efficacy, and so on. In the European Union, we have the new regulation and the implementation of post-market surveillance and vigilance systems. The second pillar concerning management of medical devices and equipment, starting from procurement, going to maintenance, vigilance, training, and again safety during use. And here the role of clinical engineering is very important. And finally, we have the assessment that also looks to safety after for a number of years evidence is available, and clinical and cost effectiveness, as well as ethics and social issues. In the legal framework in Europe, we had in the past the three directives in the 90s on active implantable medical devices, the medical devices in general in 1993, and the in vitro diagnostics later on, together with guidelines on the use of these directives and harmonized standards that devices have to fulfill in order to get approval to be on the market. Due to some cases of failures and adverse events that happened, and with the occasion of the last one with breast implants, the European Union decided to pass from directives to a more strict legal framework, and they produced the regulations that are necessary to become national law in the member states. And so in 2017, we have the 745 regulation on medical devices and the 746 on in vitro diagnostics. So now the medical devices have to fulfill these regulations in order to be able to put the CE mark and be accepted to all European national markets. Due to COVID-19, the application of these regulations have to be postponed, and exceptions have been introduced to face urgent needs of medical devices. Picture demonstrates the need for management. The health technology care unit should ensure that the equipment functions as intended by the manufacturers, and the key role towards achieving this goal is the role of clinical engineering departments. The main purpose of these departments is to maximize the benefits of medical technology to come directly to the patients and ensure the safe, effective, and efficient use of medical equipment. In order to demonstrate how clinical engineers are really a partner, very important partner in managing a hospital for hospital managers, we have to look at the different tasks that clinical engineering departments are fulfilling, starting from the investment planning, going to purchase of medical equipment, where the technical specification is one of the most critical issues in a call for tender, Then when the hospital has decided on the equipment that is going to procure, acceptance testing is necessary, creation of also of a continuous updated inventory using correct nomenclature is of great importance. Then it comes the maintenance part with preventive and corrective maintenance, the user training in order to assure that the equipment is used correctly, the vigilance and post-market surveillance, and finally the equipment disposal when the technology becomes obsolete. In all these steps and tasks, a lot of data are generated. And if a KPI are used, they can provide very important information for a hospital manager, but also for evidence for to be used in health technology assessment. Quickly to these different tasks, the first one in equipment planning and for acquisition, clinical engineers are play a very important role in its analysis, technical evaluation, financial evaluation, comparative assessment of medical equipment. Procurement phase, as I said already, the preparation of technical specifications is very important for the call for tender in order to be sure that you are the hospital acquires what really needs and not something much that is much more expensive or less performant, on the contrary, that the one it is necessary for this hospital. I will just use the slides for the complete of my presentation, but I will go quickly through them in summary. Acceptance testing is also very important because the hospital has to know if it really receives what has been ordered by during the contract phase and what is delivered by the manufacturer or the representative. And then a very important is the inventory that has to be continuously updated so that the hospital knows exactly what is really his equipment, let's say, available in the hospital in order to treat correctly the patients in a safe and efficient way. The importance of the inventory became very clear, especially during the pandemic, where the hospitals and the national healthcare systems in general needed to have a clear picture of the available equipment, and especially the crucial one for COVID-19 treatment, in order to estimate the real needs for additional equipment and be able to reallocate them when necessary. Some more details. The need for medical equipment inventory is very important because it provides a real-time and clear view of the available equipment, allows correct strategic planning, knowing the existing equipment and versus the real needs that are necessary. It is the basis for the management of medical equipment and also the basis for vigilance purposes to know if equipment that are recalled by the authorities and the manufacturers are also available in the inventory of the medical devices in the hospital and take the appropriate steps to take all the necessary actions and correct the devices that are faulty. Preventive maintenance improves the operational conditions and increases the reliability of the equipment, prolongs the useful lifetime, and also prevents serious faults and adverse events. And also, of course, whatever is the equipment, corrective maintenance sometimes comes and it is necessary in order to repair the equipment and give them again safe to be used by the users. The decision on what is the procedure to follow the corrective maintenance is a critical, is very critical for many reasons in the hospital, safety reasons, but also cost-effectiveness reasons. And I would give you an example on how clinical engineering departments can be very active in this field. Here is a case study on the decision on what type of service contract should be used by hospitals. It's from a hospital in Greece, Sotiria Hospital in Greece, and they study alternative ways of having corrective maintenance in their equipment of bronchoscopes and endoscope washers. And the three alternative scenarios were the existence of a contract on a case-to-case basis. So when there is a need of corrective maintenance, to call the representative to correct it, or to have a partial contract so that preventive maintenance is included, but not corrective maintenance. Corrective maintenance is also on call, and have also at the end the most full maintenance contract, including spare parts and rules for limited downtime available. Apply these three different systems in five units like this in for a period of 4 years. They had groups of five units in each category, and they estimated the costs. They found out that during the first two scenarios, the total days out were more than 1,000 for the five days per year for the five equipment. So 50%, more than 50% of the equipment were out of use during this period due to corrective and preventive maintenance procedures on call. And the third scenario has really almost zero downtime. And this is compared to the cost of the different scenarios. This is the interesting scenario that could be used. Why? Because in fact, in spite of the expenses that they were almost double compared to the first scenario of case-to-case call, the net income from the possibility to use the full, to take the full benefit of these devices were more than or almost 3 million euros with the days off that of 0 days off that they had. So in fact, the hospitals, by spending twice or 150,000 euros per year for these devices, they had a double net income, continuous operation of the equipment, and zero patient waiting. That's very important, I think, as an demonstrates that spending a little bit more for maintenance and having maintenance contracts where appropriate, of course, can provide you more income for the hospital. Also, quality assurance and safety tests, like electrical safety, for instance, is very important in order to assure that the equipment continues to be functioning as intended by the manufacturer. And user training is another very important a factor that clinical engineers are playing an important role, because clinical engineers, knowing very well the devices, they can also play a role of, let's say, coaches for the users to correctly use the devices. And as it was acknowledged by the European Commission, it was estimated that about 10% of patients admitted in a hospital were exposed to adverse events. About one third of them were associated with infections, but many others with user errors, medication-related errors, or surgical errors, or errors in diagnosis, but also to some medical device So risk management and vigilance is also an important task for biomedical engineers in the hospital environment. And if we want to see what type of adverse events could happen in the hospital environment, as I said already, medication is in the clinical process is one of the most important, but also failures of medical devices is also one of the reasons. And this is because even the best design products could potentially fail in the clinical practice and produce or cause serious problems to patients or even the users and the clinical staff. The purpose of a vigilance system has been acknowledged from the European Union and the most of the developed countries and their systems that have been put in place in order to avoid at least the repetition, the same type of adverse events to happen again. And this system in Europe includes the competent authorities, the manufacturers and the users, and there are two reporting systems, the user reporting system from the users to the competent authority when a failure of a medical device is on the basis of an adverse event that caused serious problems or death of a patient. And also from the users, the information goes through the post-market surveillance to the manufacturers. Finally, the competent authorities and the manufacturers are collaborating together to analyze and invest investigate the case of medical device failure and the adverse event in order to decide whether or not the medical equipment has or device has to be recalled and take the necessary steps in order to avoid the repetition of such an adverse event in the future. Finally, coming to the equipment disposal. This could happen due to changes in standards or the technology, probably a new technology that is more cost-effective and more safe and efficient will impose the change and the replacement of an existing technology, or other factors like safety or problems with cost of frequent and expensive repairs could lead to replacement of a technology. And the critical decision should be evidence-based and information coming from the clinical engineering department and management systems is the most critical one in taking such decisions from the hospital. Just to complete this picture, it is necessary today for the departments of clinical engineering to use computerized maintenance management systems in order to be able to manage all these information that it is available and data, and retrieve this data in such a way that critical. Finally, before ending my presentation, just a few words on health technology assessment. That is a multidisciplinary process summarizing information about medical, social, technological, economic, and ethical issues related to the use of health technology in an unbiased, transparent, and robust So, as a tool, health technology assessment provides information and evidence on technical characteristics, and here the role of clinical engineering is very important. Comparative clinical effectiveness, comparative cost effectiveness between technologies, health delivery organizational aspects, but also legal aspects and social and ethical implication of a technology. I hope that finishing my presentation, that clinical engineering departments have a key role in cost-effective and evidence-based overall management of medical equipment, and also in reducing adverse incidents through safety testing and the implementation of a reliable medical devices vigilance system. So, I repeat the title of my presentation: Clinical Engineering Provides an Invaluable Contribution in Modern Hospital Management. Thank you very much for listening to me. And I hope next it will be in a face-to-face basis. Thank you again.
Yeah, thank you, Professor. So, are there any questions? Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, are there any questions to Professor Pallikarakis? Well, in case there are no questions, we would like to thank you for the interesting presentation and to wish you good health and success in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you as well from my side. Thank you, Professor.
Yeah.